A very good evening. Welcome to News at 9, live from the news studios of Rupavahini.
Hello there, I'm Daphne Charles.
And I'm Rohan Mendes. The 71st birth anniversary of Speaker Chama Rajapaksa has been celebrated. The book covering his 25 years of political life entitled Chama Rajapaksa Charita Padana was launched at the BMICH yesterday under the patronage of President Mahinda Rajapaksa. Well, the book covering the life and life of Mr. Chama Rajapaksa and his political activities has been written by a former Deputy Inspector General of Police, Punya De Silva. The book was presented to the President. Mr. Chama Rajapaksa was born on the 30th of October 1942, received his preliminary education at Richmond College, Galle. He entered social service activities under the guidance of his father and joined the police service. Later, he held several posts in various institutions. Mr. Rajapaksa entered active politics from the by-election held for the Mulkirigal electorate in 1985 and has served as a deputy minister and as a minister. On the 22nd of April 2010, he was appointed as the 19th Speaker of Sri Lanka. The Vice-Chancellor of the Colombo University, Dr. Kumara Hirimburegama, who delivered the keynote address at the function held yesterday, said that Mr. Chama Rajapaksa is a humble politician and an exemplary character who has won the hearts of the people. He said that the late D.A. Rajapaksa can be compared to most of the contemporary politicians. He said that all the characteristics of the late D.A. Rajapaksa is possessed by Speaker Chama Rajapaksa.
නිශ්ශබ්දතාවය ක්‍රියාශීලී බව සහ මානුෂික ගුණාංග
Opposition leader Ranil Wickremesinghe, speaking at the function, said that it is a significant character of Speaker Chama Rajapaksa performing the duties of his post without any political business. Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe said that most of the people attempt to move fast. However, the speaker has the characteristic of moving forward intelligently. He said that in the parliament, the speaker spoke to the people of his own party without any biasness, and he has proved that he can carry out the work impartially. The leader of the house, Nima Siripala De Silva, speaking at the function, said that Mr. Chama Rajapaksa was a great strength to the Sri Lanka Freedom Party when the party faced difficult periods. The minister said that there are many examples in this book to be followed by the contemporary politicians. It also displays the actual character of the speaker.
රාශියක් තියෙනවා ගරු චමල් රාජපක්ෂ මැතිතුමනි
Members of the Mahasangha, the First Lady, Lady Madam Shiranti Rajapaksa, Prime Minister D.M. Jayaratna, several ministers, governors, chief ministers, parliamentarians, foreign diplomats and members of the Rajapaksa family also attended the function.
Indian media reports that despite pressure being exerted by Tamil Nadu, Indian Prime Minister Manmohan Singh will attend the Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting in Sri Lanka. The Times of India newspaper reported that a decision in this connection has been made at a special central committee meeting of the Congress Party held yesterday. The meeting has widely evaluated the pros and cons of non-participation in the Chogam and its effect on the Congress Party government. The senior members of the Congress Party have pointed out that by non-participation, there is a danger of Indo-Lanka relationship getting affected severely. The Times of India points out that it is the majority view of the Congress Party that such a situation will be unfavorable to India. The Indian Congress Party also views that Mr. Singh's non-participation in the Chogam will affect India's image regionally as well as internationally. It is also the stance of the Indian Congress Party that when there is no Indian participation, the opponents of India will become powerful at the summit. The Congress Party has pointed out that although the Tamil Nadu opposition is a significant factor, the international strategic relationships are more important than the Tamil Nadu factor. The Tamil Nadu state government had unanimously adopted a resolution that the Indian Prime Minister should not participate in the summit.
Well, 37 heads of states have already confirmed their attendance in the Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting. This is more than the number of heads of states who attended the last Shogam. This was stated by the Minister of Mass Media and Information, Kahalia Rabukwela, today. The minister made this announcement at the Cabinet Decision Announcement Media Conference held at his ministry this afternoon. Mr. Kahalia Rabukwela said that 37 heads of state have already confirmed their attendance. He said that the other heads of states will also confirm the attendance within the next few days. However, the number of confirmations received so far is more than the number of heads of states who attended the last summit. The minister also stated that investigations are being carried out about the media personnel who have violated the immigration regulations. The minister said that in the application form for entry to a country, it is mentioned under the purpose of the visit that there is a tourist visa and the purpose of the visit is for tourism. Accordingly, it is not possible to conduct lectures or hold seminars when someone enters the country under this category. They have hidden the real purpose of conducting media seminars or whatever. He said that further details can be announced only when the investigations are over. It is very clear that they have violated immigration regulations.
We now bring you a Commonwealth country profile, and our focus today is on Malaysia.
Malaysia is a federal constitutional monarchy in Southeast Asia. It consists of 13 states and 3 federal territories and has a total landmass of 329,847 square kilometers, separated by the South China Sea into two similarly sized regions, Peninsular Malaysia and Malaysian Borneo. The capital city is Kuala Lumpur. Population is 28.33 million, with 22.6 million living on the peninsula. Since independence, Malaysia has had one of the best economic records in Asia, with GDP growing an average 6.5% for almost 50 years. The economy has traditionally been fueled by its natural resources, but is expanding in the sectors of science, tourism, commerce and medical tourism. The currency is ringgit or Malaysian dollar. The country is multi-ethnic and multicultural, which plays a large role in politics. The constitution declares Islam the state religion while protecting freedom of religion. The government system is closely modeled on the Westminster parliamentary system and the legal system is based on English common law. The head of state is the king. He is an elected monarch chosen from the hereditary rulers of the 9 Malay states every 5 years. The head of government is the prime minister. It has gained the membership of Interstate Organization of the Commonwealth in 1957.
Well, the National Rupavahini has been presented with the 2013 Sumathi Award for the Best News Reporting. The National Rupavahini received 13 Sumathi Awards, including the second place award for the Best News Reader. The awards festival was held at the Sri Baba Bandaranaike International Exhibition and Conference Centre in Colombo yesterday under the patronage of the First Lady, Madam Shiranti Rajapaksa.
The organizing director of the 2013 Sumathi Awards Festival, A.D. Ranjit Kumara, was presented the list of winners by the chairman of the panel of judges, Thissalena Surya.
Hondama Rupavahini Pravruthi Vartakarane Sandaha Palawena Sthane Pidum Labanne Jathika Rupavahiniya.
The best television reporting, National Rupavahini.
Pravruthi Adhyakshika Vimuktika Karyavasamta Mema Sammane Labba Ganimata Aradhana Karanawa.
Jathika Rupavahini Pravruthi Anshe සෞද්ධිතවතුන්ට අපේ උණුසුම් සුබපැතුම් හොඳම රූපවාහිනී ප්‍රවෘත්ති නිවේදක දෙවන ස්ථානය ප්‍රවෘත්තිවල ගුණය නියම ආකාරයෙන් දැනගෙන ඉදිරිපත් කරන චමින්ද ගුණරත්න
The second place of the best television news reader චමින්ද ගුණරත්න The 2013 Sumathi Award for the Best Documentary Program was presented to the Velgampattiya Gabbara Serial Program directed by Namal Prasanna. The Alakamanda Program directed by Vinita Karunaratna was presented with the award for the Best Musical Program. The Tommy and Kitty Children's Program directed by Atula Ransirilal was presented with the award for the Best Children's Program. The award for the Best Solo Teledrama was presented to the Manushya directed by Santu Salyanagi. Nandalal of Isivara Ranakali Teledrama won the award for the Best Teledrama Art Direction. The award for the Best Teledrama Music Direction was presented to Mitra Kapuge of the Isivara Ranakali Teledrama. The third place of the Best Teledrama Direction was awarded to Vimalaratna Adhikari for his direction of the Isivara Ranakali Teledrama. Nathimi Umaya Adhikari was presented with the Talent Award for Isivara Ranakali Teledrama. Rupavahini also received two special awards of jury. Suminda Thilakasena received a special award of the jury for his direction of the Malima magazine program. Ganesha Rupavahini also received a special award of the jury in appreciation of its educational programs. Erin Vijaykon, Sisira Vijay Singha and Chandrasiri Thambavita also received awards. An award certificate was also presented to Janaka Sujiva for his direction of National Rupavahini's Mang Asai Matakiana Children's Educational Program. The Sumathi Award for the Best Actor this year was presented to Vishwajit Gunasekara. The award for the Best Actress was presented to Kanchana Mendis. The Sumathi Award for the Popular Actor was presented to Vishwa Kodikara. The award for the Popular Actress was presented to Dinakshi Priyasad. Lifetime Awards of UW Sumathipala Commemoration Awards were presented to the veteran actress Mrs. Punya Hindaniya and the veteran musician Professor Sanath Nandasiri.
The Buddhist. Peace of mind.
A special Sumati Commemoration Award was also presented to the founder of the Baudhya television channel, Venerable Dharanagava Kusaladama Thera, for establishing the first religious television channel in the country.
Peace of mind.
Now it is a great opportunity received by us to hold the Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting in Sri Lanka. It is being held in an Asian country after a lapse of 30 years. In order to enlighten the people about this historical occasion, the Sri Lanka Rupavahini Corporation organized the motorcades Podurada Madulu Harasara Sividigin Harasarin. The motorcades that started from the north and the south on the 21st of this month passed through several towns and villages and converged at the Goldfish Green yesterday. The people throughout the journeys of these motorcades presented greetings and well wishes to the president for becoming the leader of the Commonwealth for the next 2 years. The motorcade from the south started from Thissa Maharama. The motorcade from the north started from near the Nallur Kovil in Jaffna. The motorcade passed through 120 towns, and in each of these towns, several thousand people, including students, ministers, parliamentarians, and regional politicians, warmly welcomed the motorcade, extending their greetings and well wishes. On each of these days, Nugasevana workshops and educational seminars were also held in the main towns. High appreciation from the people was received for these events. On each day there were cultural pageants as well. Motorcades converged at the Goldfish Green, joining the north with the south after their journey of 10 days. More than 1 million greetings and signatures were handed over to the president, and they were placed on display at temple trees.
The Ministry of Health informs that employees of certain health sectors organizing trade union action cannot be justified when the government has provided maximum facilities for the health service. The government has fulfilled all reasonable demands made by the trade unions of the health sector. The chairman of the Public Service United Nurses Union, Venerable Muruthettuya Anandathero, explained on this matter. The Venerable Murutta Tuyananda Thero said that they have got the allowances for uniforms enhanced without indulging in strike actions and without inconvenience in the patients. They also got 36-hour work, taken action to revise nurses' minutes and obtained other allowances as well. The Venerable Thero said that the Secretary to the Ministry of Finance has promised to provide other demands of the Public Health Services Union after the forthcoming budget. He asked when there is a positive situation like this and when their demands are being met, why the nurses should indulge in strike action. Such acts only inconvenience the innocent patients. The Venerable Thero requested the nurses not to encourage the politically motivated strike actions being planned by certain anti-national elements.
Minister Basu Rajapaksa said that by implementing the rural community welfare mobile services in all areas of the country, people's problems could be solved expeditiously. He pointed out that the time spent by public officials for this purpose could be used for the development of the country in the future. The minister made these comments participating in a progress review workshop on the 2014 Diata Kitala Rural Community Welfare Mobile Services and People's Meetings. The workshop was held recently at the Hector Kobakadwa Agricultural Research and Training Institution. As a precursor to the 2014 Diata Kitala National Exhibition, mobile services have been successfully held in 2,731 Grama Niladari divisions in the districts of Kurunagala, Puttalam and Kagala. Mobile services will be implemented throughout the country under the instructions of President Mahinda Rajapaksa.
Well, a multi-sector action plan for nutrition will be implemented throughout the country. Cabinet approval has been given for this purpose on a proposal submitted by President Mahinda Rajapaksa as the chairman of the National Nutrition Council. In the development of the country, people should be physically and mentally fit to meet the challenges. All sectors should contribute to this endeavor without confining the responsibility to the health sector alone. The President has emphasized in his proposal the importance of stakeholders from other sectors also to contribute to this program. The President has focused attention of the Cabinet Ministers to the difficulties undergone by the teachers in getting their confirmations, salary increments, loan facilities, pensions and other matters. Accordingly, he has requested for the Provincial Ministers to establish zonal education offices as teacher-friendly institutions with a dedicated staff to cater to the needs of teachers. The Cabinet approval has been given for rehabilitation and improvement of 120 kilometers of national highways under a loan of $98 million provided by the Asian Development Bank. These road developments will be implemented under the Northern Road Connectivity Project. The proposal was submitted to the Cabinet by the President in his capacity as the Minister of Finance and Planning. Sri Lanka has been listed as a Commonwealth Scholarship awarding country from this year. Accordingly, $50,000 from the funds allocated to the University Grants Commission will be contributed to the Commonwealth Scholarship Fund. This proposal has been presented to the Cabinet by Minister S.B. Dissanayake. The Cabinet has approved a proposal made by the Minister of Investment Promotion, Lakshman Yapa Abewardhana, on sectors of projects to be presented to the Commonwealth Business Forum. They include projects in the sectors of tourism and leisure, higher education and training, agriculture and also fishing, health, information technology, manufacturing and agro-processing, and also infrastructure including aviation. The Minister of Water Supply and Drainage furnished to the Cabinet details about International Conference on Water Cooperation for Community Development held recently in Anuradhapura. Representatives from 450 community-based water supply organizations from South Asian region, including India, Pakistan, Maldives and Bhutan, attended this conference and shared their experience on the subject.
Arrangements are being made to expand rubber cultivation in the northern and eastern provinces as well. 75% of the rubber-related products are now being manufactured locally. Under the Mahinda Chintana concept, several rubber development programs are now being implemented. In ancient traditional society, the main livelihood activities were chaina, paddy cultivation. And the imperialists introduced tea, rubber and coconut as the main strategies of the economy. a special place was given to rubber cultivation. In the year 1909, the Rubber Research Institution was established, and in the year 1934, the Rubber Control Department was established. Under the present government, through the Apivavamu Ratanagamu, Gamanagamu and Naganahira Navodaya programs, attention was focused on promoting the rubber industry. Some of the strategies undertaken were provision of cultivation loans, fertilizer subsidy, encouragement of rubber cultivators, introduction of new rubber varieties and provision of technical knowledge. Last year, the government spent more than 320 million rupees as assistance for the rubber industry. The production last year amounted to 150,000 metric tons and earned more than 15,720 million as foreign exchange. Malaysia, Pakistan, India, the United States, Germany, Japan, Italy and China were the main rubber importers. Steps have been taken to cultivate rubber in 10,000 acres in the districts of Vanya, Mullaitivu, Ampara, Anuradhapura and Polonnaruwa. Value-added rubber products are to be presented to the international market. The revenue earned last year from finished rubber products amounted to $900 million. The new auditorium of the Rubber Research Institution at Agalavatta will be declared open by President Mahinda Rajapaksa tomorrow. The auditorium has been named Dr. Colvin R. De Silva Auditorium. The institution is the oldest rubber research institution in the world.
Well, the Muslim Brotherhood organization held a demonstration today demanding for the resettlement of the Muslim and Sinhala people expelled from the north. The demonstrators said that for the last 23 years they were without proper shelter and they underwent very difficult life during this period. They demanded the authorities to give them their rights to live again in their original habitats. They also alleged that certain groups are attempting to deny them their original habitats. The convener of the Muslim Brotherhood, Muhammad Muzamil, said that the innocent Muslim and Sinhala people who were expelled from the north overnight should be resettled immediately. He said that they are holding a peaceful demonstration demanding for justice to the injustices they were subjected to. The opposition leader of the Colombo Municipal Council, M.H. Manzil, said that they are honorably requesting to resettle all Muslim and Sinhala people who were expelled from the northern province.
A very good evening indeed. Welcome to the sports news with me, Chamindi Samarasekara. In the two 2020 matches played between Sri Lanka A team and Kenya A team, both teams won one match each. The matches were played at the CCC grounds in Colombo. In the 7-match 2020 series, the fourth match between the two teams were played this morning. The Sri Lankan team won the match by 9 wickets. Kusal Perera, once again displaying his cricketing talents, scored 54 runs in 43 deliveries. Dinesh Chandimal scored 32 runs. Ramit Rambupala and Lahir Jayaratne took 2 wickets each. Kenya won the fifth match played in the afternoon by 6 wickets. In this match, Kusal Perera scored 56 runs in 47 deliveries. Lahir Jayaratne took 2 wickets for 15 runs. Accordingly, Sri Lanka is lead in the 7-match series with 4-1.
That's where we end tonight's edition of Rupawani News. And together with Daphne and Shamindi, I'm Rohan Mendes saying thanks for watching. Good night.
Good night.